And this is Job 20 and verse 5. That the triumphing of the wicked is short and the joy of the hypocrite for a moment. Kal halalia, how abashem, yahawashai abashem, wakwa kadash. Double honest to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone, where I learned this truth from. Peace and salutations to our brothers on down, teaching, preaching, pushing this gospel, good news to four corners of the earth, waking up the hopeful elect of Israel. Greetings also to the few sisters that tune into these video epistles. We're staying on the slavery theme, calling this lesson prophecy, embracing slavery, kind of getting ahead of ourselves purposely on this lesson here, because we're looking back at slavery, whereas the other 17 nations, they've got it to look forward to. So we just got a couple of scriptures here. We're going to take a sideway look at this. They've got it coming. Let's get straight back into the scriptures. We're a bunch of distractions as usual. We're staying laser focus on these prophecies in the book. That's a bridge to our salvation. We're not going to let anything or anyone get in the way of what our vision or focus is supposed to be. Let's get back to it. Job, let's start now at 4. Knowest thou not this of old, since man was placed upon earth, that the triumphing of the wicked is short and the joy of the hypocrite for a moment? Though his excellency mount up to the heavens and his head reach into the clouds, yet he shall perish forever like his own dung shit, so you understand. They which have seen him shall say, where is he? He shall fly away as a dream and shall not be found. Yea, he shall be chased away as a vision of the night. Who is this speaking about? It's that Edomite, the so-called white man, the liar, deceiver. That's the man. His triumphing is short because our power, whose name is Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shai, Yahweh meaning he is, he to be, the existing one. Yahweh Shai, he's our redeemer, savior, high priest in the heavens, and mediator there standing on the right hand or sitting on the right side of his father, making intercession for his people. And he set up a bound that this man, he can't pass it. No matter how big and bad he thinks he is, he just can't get beyond the bounds that has been set. And as a matter of fact, slavery is at his door. Let's go. Jeremiah 30, 16 and 17. Therefore, all they that devour thee shall be devoured, and all thine adversaries, every one of them shall go into captivity, and they that spoil thee shall be a spoil, and all they that prey upon thee will I give for a prey. For I will restore health unto thee, and I will heal thee of thy wounds. Who he's speaking about is us, the Hebrew Israelites. They dare to call us bywords of Negroes, Latinos, Native Americans, the dispersed and diaspora. We spread to the four corners of the earth due to our disobedience to our power. But he's saying, I will restore health unto thee, and I will heal thee of thy wounds, saith the Lord, because they call thee an outcast, saying, this is Zion, whom no man seeketh after. The tables are about to turn. Isaiah 34, 5 to 8. For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Behold, it shall come down upon Idumea. That's the Greek way of saying Edom. It's that white man, that red, pinky, leprous man. That's who he is, with that wicked spirit inside of him. We know other nations can appear like him, but that's the one, that's the phenotype. That's who we're speaking about, the Edomite, Idumea, and upon the people of my curse. See, he's got this permanent curse. He can't get it off him to judgment. The sword of the Lord is filled with blood. It is made fat with fatness and with the blood of lambs and goats, with the fat of the kidneys of rams. For the Lord hath a sacrifice in Bozra. What's that Bozra? It's the capital of where this man is. and a great slaughter in the land of Idumea. And the unicorn shall come down with them, and the bullocks with the bulls, and their land shall be soaked with blood. A lot of killing is getting ready to take place, and their dust made with fatness. Why? For it is the day of the Lord's vengeance, and the year of recompense, the payback for the controversy of Zion. What controversy is that? It's because he put his hands on the Most High's people, his favorites. Isaiah, staying in Isaiah, I think 14. Another heavy verse here. Heavy chapter, I should say, 1 and 2 to begin with. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose Israel and set them in their own land. And the strangers shall be joined with them, and they shall cleave to the house of Jacob. And the people shall take them and bring them to their place. And the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord for servants and handmaids. It's slavery. That's what these other 17 nations have got. How do you get around these scriptures? You're going to be in the land of the Lord for servants and handmaids. And they shall take them captives, whose captives they were. And they shall rule over their oppressors. How do you get around these scriptures? You're going into slavery. You're going to have to melt all of your weapons. They're going to be melted. That's what you're using to bully the whole world. Verse 14 of Isaiah 14, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I'm not going to read the whole thing. You'd have to read it yourself. But it's the so-called white man thinking he's lifted up on high. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the size of the pit. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man? See, you're just a man. You're no God. That made the earth to tremble, that did shake kingdoms, that made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities thereof, that opened not the house of the prisoners. That's what people's going to be, that's what they're going to be saying. This man thinks he's just got temporary charge of the earth, as it says, Job 9 and 24. But what has he been doing with his charge? Recently, look at a few things. Oh no, you've got to put this diaper on your face. You've got to take this magic potion. He's promoting or defending the, what we refer to as the alphabet lifestyle, growing babies outside of the womb like that movie, en masse. He's got armed robots and robot dogs. He's funding wars. He's got a dependency of drugs and weapons. He's pushed this drug culture, thug, destructive feminism, single parenting. You get rid of the man and so you can get all these benefits. And so people still can't see who this man is. The Edomite, he's put his hands on the wrong people. Let's get apple of his eye scriptures here. Let's go. Where are we? Deuteronomy 32. Let's go from 8 to 10. When the Most High divided to the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land and in the waste howling wilderness he led him about. He instructed him, he kept him as the apple of his eye. See? It's a very exclusive arrangement. The Most High, he has his favorites. Let's go to Psalms, I think. Psalm 17. Let's go from 8. Keep me as the apple of the eye, hide me under the shadow of thy wings from the wicked that oppress me. That's another name for this so-called white man, Malachi 1 and 4. It's the wicked. He's known as the border of wickedness. It's the Edomites. It's the whole nation. They've been put into the earth to perform these wicked deeds and be oppressive to the whole of the earth, and especially his target, the Hebrew Israelites, and in this time, the remnant. Keep me as the apple of the eye, hide me under the shadow of thy wings. From the wicked that oppress me from my deadly enemies who compass me about. They are enclosed in their own fat with their mouth. They speak proudly. They have now compassed us in our steps. They have set their eyes bowing down to the earth, like as a lion that is greedy of his prey, and as it were a young lion lurking in secret places. Arise, O Lord, disappoint him, cast him down, deliver my soul from the wicked, which is thy sword. See, that was his blessing given to him by Isaac in Genesis 27, around about 38 to 40. He was given the sword as his blessing, and he's been ruling in absolute terror from men which are thy hand, O Lord, from men of the world which have their portion in this life. See, when it's all over, they've got nothing left to get apart from slavery, hardcore slavery. And whose belly thou fillest with thy hid treasure? They are full of children and leave the rest of their substance to their babes. See, they can keep passing down what you call generational wealth. As for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. That's his way. Scripture said he's going to be put in our mind. The laws, statutes, and commandments. It's going to be etched in there. We're never going to be able to sin or go off again. Zechariah, we want one here. Zechariah just goes to the point. 2 verse 8. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, after the glory hath he sent me unto the nations which spoiled you. For he that toucheth you toucheth the apple of his eye. So he's real big brother talk here. How dare you put your hands on my people? Payback is coming for this leprous man. We had one here in First Chronicles. Let's get that. First Chronicles 16, starting at 13. Oh, see, this is really a psalm of David. Oh, ye seed of Israel, his servant, ye children of Jacob, his chosen ones. This is the jealousy. They hate this truth. They hate the scriptures. They hate our power. They hate the sun, the angels. They're against a total adversary. That's what Satan means. Oh, ye seed of Israel, his servant, ye children of Jacob, his chosen ones. He is the Lord our God, Yahweh, our power. His judgments are in all the earth. Be ye mindful always of his covenant, the word which he commanded to a thousand generations, even of the covenant which he made with Abraham, and of his oath with Isaac, and hath confirmed the same to Jacob for a law, and to Israel for an everlasting covenant, saying, unto thee will I give the land of Canaan, the lot of your inheritance, when ye were but few, even a few, and strangers in it, and when they went from nation to nation, and from kingdom to another people. He suffered no man to do them wrong, yea, he reproved kings for their sakes, saying, touch not mine anointed, and do my prophets no harm. Get your hands off of my people, you leprous man. That's what he said. We know what we've got coming. Full scale, Jacob's trouble is at the door. That's Jeremiah 30 and 7, I believe. And so we know there's more pestilences coming, war, etc. Let's get one last scripture here. 2 Esdras 7. Let's start at 6. 2 Ezra 7 and 6. There's also another thing. A city is builded and set upon a broad field and is full of all good things. The entrance thereof is narrow and is set in a dangerous place to fall, like as if there were a fire on the right hand and on the left a deep water. You've got to picture this when you're reading it. Some brothers have done some images. It was really fantastic. You see water on one side, really deep, and fire on the left. And hear this description here. and one only path between them both, even between the fire and the water, so small that there could but one man go there at once. If this city now were given unto a man for an inheritance, if he never shall pass the danger set before it, how shall he receive this inheritance? So we've got no choice. You've got to go through the narrow path. And I said, it is so, Lord. Then said he unto me, even so also is Israel's portion. Verse 11, because for their sakes I made the world. Whose sakes? It's for Israel's sakes. And when Adam transgressed my statutes, then was decreed that now is done. Then were the entrances of this world made narrow, full of sorrow and travail. They are but few and evil, full of perils and very painful. For the entrances of the elder world were wide and sure, and bought immortal fruit. If then they that live labor not to enter these straight and vain things, that's straight, spelled S-T-R-A-I-T, mean it's a path of difficulty, and vain things, they can never receive those things that are laid up for them. So that's where we are. We've been going through, it's nearly 2,000 years, I believe, in total, of various captivities that the Hebrew Israelites have gone through. Various, like, slaveries going on. And we've reached the end. We're at the end of this last heathen captivity. And so we're looking forward to having these bastards in slavery. And we're looking back at the time that we've done. We've served our time. We've got this pestilence, Jacob's trouble, and we know it's going to be tough. But you're projecting our mind forward to rulership. And some people just can't do that. We have to do it. We're looking forward when this upside down world is put in order and everything that we see happening around us is put back where it's supposed to be. The laws, statutes, and commandments put into our minds. We won't be able to go off anymore. What a wonderful time that will be. Righteousness in the earth once again. So I want to stretch the lesson beyond where it needs to be. Hopefully I can come back and do maybe a short lesson later. But you've been listening to Prophecy, Embracing Slavery. Shalom, until the next one.